The title of the conference, this conference, and the challenge I've been given is a new era in maritime security, question mark. And I'm not sure about that question mark, and hope over the next few minutes to show you why I'm not sure. Let me start with an assertion. Very many of my maritime colleagues, both military and commercial, nationally and internationally, judge that we are on the cusp of much greater maritime responsibility. And believe me, this is not wishful thinking. Not wishful thinking because some of those responsibilities are eye-watering. And they bring substantial technical, professional, and moral challenges. And we know that we must be ready. So, why might we be on the cusp of something different? What has changed? Let me build a case for you. First, a bit of a reminder. After the fall of Saigon in 1975, by which time US troop numbers in Vietnam had fallen from a peak of 750,000 to 140, the US government stuck doggedly to a non-interventionist foreign policy until Grenada in 1983. Why? Well, it's complicated. But at least part of that was a judgment on the strategic value of intervention. For us, after two long land wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, the permanent presence again of boots on the ground is part of another strategic judgment above my pay grade. But we in the Royal Navy need to be ready to meet whatever is judged should be our contribution in the context of the next strategic judgment. And the sea, the almost forgotten option, at least until Libya reminded us otherwise, offers options and access and unique opportunities for agile, controlled, and disciplined military and political effect. As the First Sea Lord puts it, engagement without embroilment. Of course, it doesn't help if the challenge happens to be 500 miles from the sea, and I accept that. But with 40 commando on the ground in Afghanistan as I speak, the Royal Navy right now has more than 600 military personnel on land operations in that theater. We carry our weight, the more so when you consider our relative size, the smallest of the three services. And when you consider the extraordinarily wide range of other defense tasks that fall to us. But even the prospect of operating at long range from the sea hasn't stopped the United States Navy from making a major contribution from the sea to the coalition air effort over Afghanistan. And as you know, it is our government's intention to give rebirth to that capability too. And as I said, Libya makes the obvious most recent case, reflecting that the vast majority of the world's population lives by the sea, and ladies and gentlemen, when I last looked, most capitals too. Okay, so that's my first argument. Security options from the sea in a period that might have a different tolerance for boots on the ground. Second, economics. Even the most recent experience reminds us how interdependencies of trade and energy security can combine with international politics and fiscal uncertainty to threaten national interests. In such circumstances, sudden uncertainty in the Gulf, or oil at too many dollars a barrel, will prove critical to vulnerable economies or already fragile business confidence. But what we do know is that in a crisis, early reassurance of the markets is fundamental as a first step through coordinated action and very quick and clear messaging. So, credible military capability, probably multinationally, is a key part of the early and unequivocal response and the reassurance that the markets will be waiting for in a crisis. And so credible market reassurance based on an assured reputation is the second argument on my list. Third, what some might call routine Navy business. The Royal Navy is out there right now conducting maritime security by enforcing UN resolutions, a daily dose of empowerment of the international community's will, by countering drugs, piracy, and the proliferation of weapons, by fighting against terrorism at the sea and from the sea. So what's different? What's different is the increased interoperability with other maritime forces, which can pay off so well when more challenging operations arise. And interoperability, most obviously, with our principal partners, the United States and France. But also, more generally, in the counter-piracy effort of Somalia, maritime cooperation includes the Russian, Chinese and Iranian navies amongst what I might generously call the usual crowd. And the fluency of NATO's combined maritime response off the coast of Libya owes much to the foundations that were laid in the course of NATO's Operation Active Endeavour in the Eastern Mediterranean. So, while maritime security isn't the only game in town for maritime forces, it is a game worth investing in. It is a universal socket for maritime cooperation, and cooperation is the first step, essential first step, to coalition performance, which is the vital raw ingredient of international political consensus. That is the golden thread we pursue. And fourth, NATO. Forgive me if you already know this, but following NATO restructuring, the UK has been given the extraordinary privilege of responsibility of being the sole maritime commander for NATO. So a year from now, and we're on that demanding trajectory right now, the NATO headquarters at Northwood, under a UK three-star, will provide command, capability design, advice, and take the lead on all NATO maritime assets. And if you didn't know what that amounts to, it is nominally 750 ships and 800,000 men and women under command. Tie this in with the UK MOD's stated ambition to put NATO at the heart of defence, and by any measure, this is much greater national maritime responsibility. So there's my four pieces of evidence for you. Security options from the sea, balanced against the politics and practicalities of boots on the ground. Economic and market reassurance in a golden thread. Greater interoperability and the political utility that comes from that. And finally, greater, much greater NATO responsibility. And amongst that list of four come both hard and soft effects. To be credible, you need to be able to demonstrate the necessary range of hard and soft capabilities and connectivities. Not at the scale we once had, but with the quality we now need. I recognise that mass does matter, but it is about quality too. Top-end coalition interoperability buys us into greater mass. But the price of admission is that our contribution must be based on quality, and in turn, this contribution empowers political buy-in and consensus, and frankly, is easier to sell. So, Adding all this together, that's why I believe that we're on the cusp of greater responsibility. Because all these demands on us are real and contemporary. Quality maritime security will remain strongly in demand, if not become much more so. I believe there is a new era, and we're already in it. But in responding to the opportunity that it brings, we need to find and exploit our own maritime edge. And this edge has to be set in the context of some realities. Current economics and the pressure on our limited defence and security assets all mean that we need to be realistic about what we choose to do and what we can afford to do. In my opinion, in pursuing this edge, the success of the maritime security contribution must be linked to the smart pursuit of results ashore. After all, what happens at sea is all about what eventually happens on the land. Maritime security challenges, even if they might manifest themselves in the open oceans, still tend to resolve themselves closer to the shore or on the shore. For example, if you analyse the business model which currently underpins Somali piracy, you'll quickly deduce that the way to cause the pirate's business model to fail is in part the containment of the problem by the use of international military effort at sea and embarked private security teams. But better, much better, is prevention by introducing rule of law ashore and through better government and governance. And at last, this is happening. And the picture before and after says it all. So, my contention is that if we want to do better at maritime security, finding our edge, getting more out of what we've got, we also have to focus on the land. In this regard, time is crucial. Early decisions create political and military options. Late decisions reduce them. So this all needs the political will, when possible, to use time to advantage. The aim must be to decide early, move early, think clearly, and if necessary, wait for the effects to be utilised, or not. This is what navies can do. Having spent 2 years of my professional life focused on Iraq and Afghanistan, I am determined that what we learned there at the tactical and operational level must be pulled through into the maritime domain. And these lessons apply as much to maritime security as they do to other types of maritime operations. So what are these lessons, and are we ready to learn them? Lesson one is this. Before we act, we must be much better at understanding the environment in which we will act. Much better. Currently, navies don't invest nearly enough in understanding what is happening on their principal flank, the land. Human terrain mapping, or understanding the politics, the cultural, the tribal, the social, the economic, and the ethnic characteristics of human terrain in this coastal region is largely inadequate. We're not good at it. If we're serious about offering policy choice to politicians, we need to make the case for investment in the things that provide better judgment and greater utility closer into the shore and on shore, where all the complexity of rules of engagement, policy, legal, meet a multi-domain threat environment. Our information or intelligence machine is not sufficiently optimized for that. So my first lesson from the land campaign in Iraq and Afghanistan is that the understand function, as we call it, the understand function needs to be much better delivered, and that separating land and sea, though it might suit military planners and individual services, is not the best way to go about things. Part of the answer on this edge must be greater precision. We can't necessarily rely on mass anymore, so we'd better be prepared to invest in precision. Now, I'm not just talking about kinetic effects here, hard effects. My ambition for greater precision crosses the entire spectrum of hard and soft what a maritime force could and should deliver. As I have said, central to the delivery of effect on the land is our ability to reach an understanding of what is happening there. Many navies, ours included, have spent decades optimizing our performance in the open oceans, and for good reason. And our doctrine and training reflect this in minute detail. But get navies nearer the shore, and it gets complicated. And understandably so, because we begin to feel the heat of politics and pragmatics. Improving our ability to understand might mean more time listening and researching, more history lessons, dare I say it, more analysis, more time spent managing data effectively, more watching, more drones, and more reliance on robust reach back, which means connecting back to the information sources which can help you do your job. We need to spend months understanding, not minutes. Lower cost ISTAR solutions, able to be launched and recovered by the seagoing unit like Scan Eagle, may be less attractive solutions to industry, but we need to save the sophistication for where we really need it. So I prefer to take an approach which I describe as dull up front. I'd rather use simple and available equipment more effectively. The Navy is years late in raising its game on ISTAR, and perhaps industry sees the opportunity to grow a market share through lend-lease of ISTAR. After all, some of the equipment is not that expensive. Certainly, no defence ISTAR assets should be underutilised. Better, surely, would you make use of developing technologies, unmanned, off-board, persistent, remotely controlled equipment with a robust reach-back facility. On the kinetic side, we all know that claims for new weaponry should be treated with a degree of scepticism. But there are some areas where we can perhaps be more confident. Many navies, of course, already use precision munitions, whether delivered by subsurface, surface, or air platforms. And on the latter point, we should note very carefully that the United States Navy intends to deliver unmanned strike within 2 years from its carriers. The more challenging ISTAR test for me is through the naval gun. Once a relatively simple concept, the naval gun has been increasing in its sophistication and looks set to offer a great deal more. I can see within a short space of time the development of a relatively low-cost projectile with GPS fins and a range of 100 kilometers, which will strike deep targets with great accuracy and minimal collateral damage. Which links me back to my first lesson from Afghanistan, the need to understand sufficiently what the environment is in which precision effect is used. In this way, our maritime security operations, even those that influence outcomes on the land, can meet the most stringent tactical, moral, and political constraints. And maritime ISTAR, persistent maritime ISTAR, has to fill that gap. But my key point is that with strike from subsurface, surface, and air, the maritime has a responsibility that does not stop at the high water mark. Far from it, and we need to think quickly about the reach and access and responsibilities that navies will bring. Navies need to think better about how they interact with land and air forces and the capabilities they bring. Not just across the boundaries for land and sea, but within the totality of the maritime domain itself. And we need to train as we mean to fight in the totality of the domain. All this All of this is about operationalizing maritime security to a far greater extent than we do now. It means seeing the maritime air land domain through the eyes of the comprehensive approach and extracting the best juices of the last two land campaigns and keeping true to those lessons. And if you want one great example, ask me about biometrics and questions. I don't want to make this enhanced, more conjoined maritime contribution sound too easy or too inexpensive. But deployed maritime assets take their logistic chain and their fighting arms with them for both soft and hard effects. No vulnerable southern supply route through Karachi here. Ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude. As well as doing what we do now, and doing it better, more efficiently, I believe that navies, and my own included, if they are agile enough, are on the edge of a much wider security opportunity. We do need to do more, and we do need to do more carefully and cleverly to be more relevant, and especially to move closer to the shore, not necessarily physically, as I've said, but professionally. And we need to learn better from Iraq and Afghanistan, as well as history, to make the most of our maritime security responsibility and give politicians real options in how they respond. Thank you. Thank you.